testimony exactly what you mean by content-based discrimination. How is this legislation specifically discriminating on content-based issue? Please point out the section. Please explain how you think it's content-based and how it is as opposed to other places that have wild animals. My other question is, federal law doesn't distinguish between circus and zoos and other things you said in your testimony. But to me, they're different. I want to know if you think they're different. And if you don't think they're different, I want to understand how you don't, you know, why you don't think it's different. I want to know how Ringling Brothers or Feld Entertainment or any, actually all of these services, how do you work with local law enforcement regarding public safety and escaped animals? And I hope to come back and catch some of those answers myself. Thank you.
Thank you. You can start whatever more you'd like answering those questions.
Sorry, Ms. Carolyn. I'm trying to write down the council members' questions here. So, regarding the question of content-based, I mean, we believe that is the case here because all you're really doing is prohibiting animal performances in a circus environment. But the bill as written would allow the exact same activities to occur in another setting, in which that is the only difference. The bill does not say anything about how animals are trained or handled. It just says if it's in this context, it's okay. There's reference made to AZA accreditation, but let me point out that AZA is a private trade association for zoos. And we don't have a problem with zoos. We work closely with a lot of zoos. We help zoos, they help us. It is part of a larger community. But AZA is a private trade association for zoos. And its accreditation standards focus primarily on physical facilities for which in which animals are kept and displayed. That's not the only thing they address, but it is the primary focus. It is about regulating the physical facility. My point being that having an AZA accredited connection to an animal doing a performance somewhere doesn't tell you anything about how that animal is handled or trained. We also would note that, in fact, if it's true, the bill would allow camels to stand on the stage at Radio City Music Hall with the Rockettes, but camels would not be allowed to run around the ring at the circus. Again, that seems totally based on it's happening at a circus. That's bad, but if it's happening at Radio City Music Hall, that's okay. Constitutionally, I mean, circus is like any other artistic endeavor. It is a form of expression. It is a form of speech. And like any other artistic endeavor, it is protected as a form of freedom of speech. So you can't just decide that you're going to not allow something because you don't like it, but then make exceptions that let the same activities occur.
Are you a lawyer?
Yes, I am. So, and this is something we have looked at. I would also...
Have you challenged ordinances in other places where these have been enacted? Has this been litigated?
I'm not aware that it's been litigated. Most of the ordinance.
So if it hasn't been litigated, how are you so sure that we're violating the First Amendment?
It's based on legal research and opinion.
But there's been no court case on this?
Not that I'm aware of.
So we're giving your opinion, but not the opinion of a court of law?
True.
Okay, thank you.
The mention to other municipalities, part of the reason we haven't seen challenges necessarily, one is they don't always, a lot of those don't contain these kinds of exceptions. So San Francisco was mentioned. It has no exceptions in there, at least not for movies or performances at stages or anything like that. The other reason we haven't seen challenges is most of these bans happen in municipalities where we don't play. Even San Francisco, we don't play in the city of San Francisco. There is no performance venue in the city of San Francisco that Ringling Brothers could currently perform in. We perform in a venue, it is our San Francisco engagement, but it's actually outside the city. And we have performed there since that ordinance was passed. So when it's talked about municipalities, other municipalities, the vast majority of them are municipalities where we don't play. Therefore, we have no basis to do the legal challenge because you have to have, in order to be able to do that, you have to be planning to go through here.
So maybe this will get litigated.
Regarding federal law, USDA has only one license for exhibitors. It is a Class C license. If you are exhibiting animals to the public in any way, that is the license you get. Those are the regulations you must follow. Circuses get the same license as zoos, as any sanctuary that's open to the public. In fact, sanctuaries are not required, unless they're open to the public, unless they're acting as exhibitors, they're not even required to have a federal license and be inspected by USDA, unless they're bringing in members of the public. But it is the same license, it is the same regulations, the same laws that apply to zoos, as to circuses, as to a sanctuary that has the same an exhibitor's license. In terms of local law enforcement, we obviously work to comply with any permit requirements. In New York, that's obviously the Department of Health. We certainly try to make sure we satisfy all their requirements, and we try to work with them in a cooperative way to make sure that happens. We don't even always agree with all their requirements, but we try to work with them in a constructive manner. From a safety standpoint, if there's an activity going on in a public setting, we will make sure that we are in coordination with local police or enforcement or law enforcement that might be there. We also are required to have the ability to tranquilize an animal in case of emergency. So our shows do travel with multiple dart guns with preset measurements for the necessary drugs based on the different kinds of animals. We have a protocol. All of our staff get trained on the use of how to use that. Our senior staff get trained on the use of that tranquilizer. We try to have a veterinarian or a vet tech always involved so that if there's ever a need, any kind of emergency to tranquilize an animal, that the decision to do so is made by the person who is in charge of the animal as well as
But doesn't that really get to the heart of the matter? That if exotic, wild, non-domesticated animals are behaviorally not probably suited to be traveling around the country, being transported, performing in front of thousands of people, and sometimes they may act out, that to control them, they need to be shot with a tranquilizer gun with medicine inside to calm them down. Like, doesn't that sort of tell us what, that sort of goes to the heart of, like, maybe these are animals that shouldn't be used for those purposes, if that's how they need to be potentially controlled.
What I can tell you, Mr. Chairman, is that by regulation, we are required to provide, be prepared for any possible emergency. It's not that we think that it's going to happen. I'm not aware that
doesn't happen.
I'm not aware that we've ever had a situation where we had to tranquilize an animal in there. I can't be sure of that because it's not something I specifically researched.
So in Atlanta in 2012, there was a 12-year-old zebra